complacency. Complacency yearns for destruction. And who better to tear down the complacent than the downtrodden? But the unlikely hero that we need is the hero we cannot find. Until now.
Well, kind of. While it seems like we're finally getting dribbles of B580 stock months after its launch, you do still kind of have to scrounge one up. But before we find out if it's actually worth doing some scrounging, a quick word from today's video sponsor.
If every time you use your mechanical keyboard, your coworkers and loved ones want to batter you with it, then Be Quiet's new light and dark mount silent mechanical keyboards are for you. But not only are their silent switches silent, but they also have a dazzling array of features. From a hot swappable numpad on the dark mount with display keys, very exciting, a control panel that lets you set a bunch of features without having to install any software, and a huge amount more. So go check out the Be Quiet light and dark mount keyboards using the link down below.
Now I am very excited about my B580 GPU. I spent months ineptly looking for one because I was really curious to see how it holds up. It's a mid-range-ish graphics card with 12 gigs of video memory, something that's even rarer now than it was 2 years ago for some reason. And that video memory is important considering that Intel targets this at 1440p gaming. Now in terms of stock, in Canada, recently Memory Express got a big shipment of the ASRock version of this card, although that is at over MSRP, which is pretty naughty and kind of explains why they're not selling. Now in the US, you can also get it from Micro Center, but they only have it as a shippable item. At least I think that means it's an item that's available to be shipped to a store, maybe? I don't know. You can also find it on Newegg, but the pricing is crazy. I don't know if this is a trade kerfuffle related issue, but that is absurd. It also seems to be available in Europe with prices varying in degrees of dodgy. But just because we're seeing wisps of availability doesn't mean you should necessarily buy one. So in today's video, I'm going to compare it to the most popular graphics card in the world at the moment to see if you should be interested in this ARC GPU. And in terms of system, I'm testing it in the Geek Squad system with an i5-14600K and 32 gigs of RAM. A system you'd realistically drop a B580 in. Now we're going to start off by getting a baseline reading. I'm using an RTX 4060 here, which according to Steam, all of you have, and I think it'll be really interesting to see how the B580 GPU compares to it. Now we're currently running Counter-Strike 2 at 1080p. Now obviously, at 1080p, low settings, the 4060 absolutely crashes Counter-Strike. This isn't surprising at all, but I am just using this as an example of how esports titles run on the two GPUs. And I think the takeaway is gonna be that it honestly doesn't matter which of the two graphics cards you have. But I am starting with a conclusion here, so that's not good. Our GPU utilization isn't super high, so our i5 is potentially the issue here. Now, power draw is also important. We're hovering between 80 and about 100 watts. Yeah, that's not very much for some esports titling.
I then switched over to 1440p, where we barely lost any frame rate aside from some 1% lows. And it makes sense, because of the higher resolution, we could use more of our GPU, giving us about the same performance as at 1080p.
Now, Doom Eternal is another game where, even at ultra settings, 1080p, we're getting a very high frame rate here. But the reason that I'm testing it is because I'm curious to see how the Intel GPU manages Vulkan-based games. Let's see what happens when we jump up to 1440p.
This time, jumping to 1440p does choke out our frame rate a bit, but we're still getting over 120 frames per second at ultra settings. All that with relatively low power draw. However, we are getting close to utilizing the full 8 gigs of video memory. But what happens when we move to a game with some bigger teeth?
Next, I want to have a look at Cyber Pizzle Mishizzle here, running at 1080p medium settings. Not particularly aggressive, but I do want headroom for 1440p to not be an unusable dumpster fire. And it looks like we've got quite a lot of headroom here. We've got 110-ish frames per second. About 100 frames per second in Cyberpunk does feel very good. And our frame time graph is very steady. It's stable, it knows what it wants from life, and it's willing to go out and get it. Hashtag GoBoss graphics card or whatever.
Jumping up to 1440p hits our frame rate hard, easily dipping to the low 60s. Which in direct comparison to the 1080p result does feel a lot heavier, but it's still a very playable experience. But even at 1440p, our VRAM usage is pretty low, so we're gonna have to move to a different game to push the limits of our 8 gigs.
The Last of Us, at 1080p high settings, which I chose because the game told me it would be fine at 1440p, which is not looking very promising at this point, considering that we're hitting about 70 frames per second with 1080p,
which drops down to 45 frames per second at 1440p. So this is where the graphics cards are really starting to struggle, but not quite as much as I imagine it's going to struggle with our next Unreal Engine 5 game.
Now for Stalker 2, we're gonna start off using FSR 3.1 at native AA, which, as far as I've been able to figure out, is the best way to get Stalker 2 running at native resolution without getting weird visual artifacts or whatever. Now, at 1080p medium settings, it's doing okay. It's fluctuating between 50 and 60 frames per second. It doesn't feel amazing. You can tell by our frame time graph, we do have a little bit of stuttering going on. This is an area where there's a lot of NPCs, which does hit the performance quite hard, and this can't help. Whatever's going on here is definitely not helping the performance, but it's like worst case scenario, right? Like this is, it's okay.
Quick side note, our GPU is being fully utilized here, so no CPU bottleneck.
And again, this isn't a game where you're not going to be using native AA. You're almost definitely going to be using DLSS. And with this result, you know, we still have reasonable input going into our upscaling.
Although that starting point does drop quite a bit lower in 1440p, where we get in the mid-40s in terms of frame rate. But with that, let's have a look at how the Intel B580 performs in rasterization workloads before we compare their upscaling chops, which is something game devs are insistent we care about these days.
So it turns out that Intel thought not enough people were using the screen capture functionality in their graphics card, so they just deleted it. It isn't an option in it anymore, which is really annoying, because the moment that you move the screen capture functionality off of the system that you're using, in my experience, the reliability of it falls by a factor of 10. So I'm pretty tilted now, to be honest. There's lots of shouting has happened, but I think we're good now. Whoa, we have way lower frame rates happening here. For some reason, the graphics card just feels like it doesn't need to interact with the game, because we've just got 50% utilization happening, which is way lower than we got with the 4060. We are still getting lots of frame rate.
But then when I briefly alt-tabbed out of the game, something weird happened.
Wait, I just alt-tabbed out and back into the game, and now suddenly we've got way, like, double the frame rate.
But it wasn't because I alt-tabbed out. The frame rate just fluctuates wildly based on where you're looking.
Oh, it varies so much depending on where you look. When jumping up to 1440p, we haven't really lost any frame rate. It's still behaving very similarly.
But it's still trailing massively behind the 4060, which I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, I mean, it's so dependent on where you look. Like, some bits give you 190 frames per second, and some bits give you 400. Oh. Now with Doom Eternal, we're getting 100% utilization at least. Now I do kind of vaguely remember that Intel GPUs didn't love Vulkan games,
but that doesn't seem to be the case anymore, because performance-wise, it's really bringing the fight to the 4060 here. Luckily with Doom Eternal, even at 1080p, we're getting 100% GPU utilization. The same goes for 1440p. We get a little bit of a lead here. Tiny, tiny little bit.
What is cool, though, is that we do have 12 gigs of video memory, so we have slightly more to play with. And with Doom Eternal, we're using 9 whole extra megabytes, which just makes me very glad we have that extra 4 gigs. Now with Cyberpunk, I'm jumping straight into 1440p, and we're getting our first B580 favored shellacking here at both resolutions and when it comes to average and 1% lows. That's a lot better. And that's while using about the same amount of power. And interestingly, it doesn't seem to be about our extra video memory. We're just using about 6 gigs here. But it's interesting to see how much game-to-game variance there is in the performance.
The last
Last of Us result was fascinating, because at 1080p, the two graphics cards basically performed the same. But when you move up to 1440p, the B580 steps convincingly ahead, and a big part of it seems to be because of the video memory, considering the video memory utilization we're seeing here. And you know, Intel did say that this was a 1440p powerhouse. But with that, let's try the destroyer of graphics cards, Unreal Engine 5. Now at 1080p medium settings, this is with native AA, so we're running at 1080p, we're getting about 60-ish frames per second. It seems to be very in line with the performance we were getting from the Nvidia GPU. It was actually a little bit slower at 1080p, but again, it manages to claw back some dignity at 1440p. But that's still a result which doesn't feel great, which is kinda to be expected of a UE5 game not using upscaling. So let's see how Intel's upscaling compares to DLSS here. Oh, that's really interesting. So with XeSS, which is Intel's upscaling technology, at least in Stalker, this varies by game, but here, you get much more granular settings for your upscaling. So you can actually start off with 76% resolution scaling, which you can't do with DLSS. DLSS, the least aggressive you can do is 66. Actually, I'm gonna start with ultra quality because that's the equivalent of what I was using in terms of DLSS. Now, when I initially saw the XeSS result, I thought it looked a lot worse than DLSS 4 because of all of this gross smearing on the lamppost, which I didn't remember Nvidia doing. But that artifact also exists on the RTX 4060 when running DLSS 4 at quality settings. It just makes the lampposts look visibly stinky. Now in other areas, DLSS looks a bit better, especially when it comes to tree smearing in the distance. But all in all, the visual artifacts may be slightly less pronounced with DLSS, but it's still there. They both also really struggle with foliage in front of a background. Ugh. I mean, this is at 1440p quality.
And I mean, those artifacts are the kind of thing that I notice a lot. It really bothers me. But it is different. Like, some people don't care about it, but that, like, that is so immersion breaking to me.
And then just a quick final note, the B580 is also really good value for content creation because it natively supports hardware acceleration for a bunch of modern media formats, which the 4060 doesn't. Although that is offset a little bit by the fact that Intel thought it was a good idea to delete screen capturing functionality. Why? Although on the note of drivers, the Intel GPU did feel more stable than the Nvidia graphics card because I did have some weird issues with the Nvidia drivers, which is something that's just generally been the case for the last 5 months with Nvidia. But all in all, I was surprised at how variable the game performance was with the B580. Cyberpunk, for example, saw the B580 dumpster the 4060, but with Counter-Strike, it was the other way around. And with that, thank you for watching. Let me know what you think of the B580 down below. Subscribe to the channel on the way there, and until the next video, bye-bye.